and we have to really escalate the noise we make so that we'll be heard.
Welcome to Gay USA. I'm Andy Hum.
I'm Ann Northrup, and let's start the show this week with tributes to two great straight allies of our community who were friends of ours and friends to all of us.
Yes, the one was psychotherapist George Weinberg, the man who coined the word homophobia in the late 1960s and fought against it, of course, all his life. He has died at 87.
And we also are going to celebrate the life and mourn the death of our friend Jimmy Breslin, Tribune of the Powerless, who won the Pulitzer Prize writing about AIDS in its early years.
Neil Gorsuch isn't saying much in his confirmation hearings, but it's emerging that all of his mentors were homophobes.
I don't find him trustworthy. The Trump administration is continuing to subvert LGBT rights and erase LGBT people from the population served by the federal government.
We made some progress in New Mexico this week and in a court in South Carolina, but anti-LGBT bills have moved forward in Kentucky, in Georgia, and Arkansas.
It's too bad George Weinberg is not still around to figure out a better way to pronounce LGBT. A boy in Pennsylvania is suing for the right not to share a locker room with a transgender boy.
We have to report on some anti-LGBT violence in Jersey City, New Jersey, and in Jackson Heights, Queens.
And Andy will review an all-star cast in Arthur Miller's The Price and the feel-good Canadian 9/11 musical, Come From Away. But let's start with George.
Well, we do start with George Weinberg, and it turns out we interviewed him here on the show.
10 years ago.
In 2007. He has died at the age of 87, and we introduce him in this clip. So why don't we look at that back in then, and then we can talk about him.
So we don't repeat our introduction.
Yes.
We'll let Andy do it 10 years ago.
Clinical psychologist and psychotherapist in New York City. In 1972, folks, before the American Psychiatric Association got rid of homosexuality as a mental disease, he wrote Society and the Healthy Homosexual. Even earlier than that, he coined the term homophobia. We're going to talk to you all about that, all that history, and all you've done for lesbian and gay rights over the years. But you're here because your society, the American Psychological Association, is finally considering, essentially condemning, what's called reparative therapy, trying to convert, you know, gay people into straight people. Why do you think this is finally coming about, and do you think they're going to do it?
I think the therapy profession is usually last to make judgments. That society always starts out with an opinion, and therapy usually copies it, and there's a groundswell now, you can't do this. The real reasons why you shouldn't convert are that it makes you hate yourself when you try to convert. That the very effort to say that you're not something, which you are, makes you condemn what you are, and you despise yourself. When I was a kid, there were hundreds of ads for skin bleachers for blacks. Well, anyone who applied one of those bleachers to get a little white, or who lied about being black, had to hate himself or herself. And if you are gay, you are condemning homosexuality, not only all other gays, but yourself. And I can tell you that I've seen gay people work heavily on conversions and then commit suicide. And there's one famous case in Philadelphia that Dr. Spitzer got involved with, and I knew the people very well and pleaded. And if you don't accept yourself, you're going to hate yourself. You have a choice.
We spent a lot of time on this show making a distinction between orientation and behavior.
Attention. Mm. Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. And we're going to post that whole interview online. It's about 16 minutes.
Yeah.
And
the only thing I would say, and I'm sure he would agree with this, is that self-hatred, self-loathing comes from the society teaching you that. It's not that we wake up in the morning and decide that. It's that we grow up in a society that teaches
us. This book came out in 1972. I remember it as a kid when almost everything that this is before the American Psychiatric Association got rid of its, got us off the index of mental disorders. And the first line of the book, Society and the Healthy Homosexual, is, I would never consider a patient healthy unless he had overcome his prejudice against homosexuality, which is a very bold statement in those days.
Yep.
I mean,
when was that?
1972.
Okay.
He wrote it in 71.
Yeah.
And he allied himself with the early movement, Frank Kameny, Lily Vincennes, Jack Nichols, all the early activists. And he appeared on lots of radio and television shows debating people like Charles Socarides, the psychiatrist who said until the day he died that we were sick and never gave up on it. And a lot of people thought George was gay as a result because he was so emphatic about these things.
No, he was just enlightened, smart, visionary, compassionate, heterosexual.
Well, when he was being trained as a psychotherapist, I mean, they had protocols about how to deal with gay people. And when he would do it, since he was being supervised by being taped, he would turn the tape recorder off with the gay guy and say, look, just find yourself someone nice and get in a good relationship. We're not allowed to talk about this. And then he'd turn it back on.
So
very subversive.
How did he come up with the term homophobia?
Well, I mean, this was his and he goes into it at length in his book, but from his observation of the way people reacted. I mean, there's one story, it's not in the book, that said that, he was on a show where
TV show.
Yes, and he was in the green room where you wait to go on, and the woman who came in to oppose him thought she was in the room with a gay person and panicked and left, and that's when he realized it was a phobia. He said, look, when people, I used to say, well, it's not really a phobia, it's more like hatred. And he said, look, when a dog snarls at you, it's afraid of you. And he said that fear blocks men from becoming ballet dancers or even hugging their boys, as children, because it's unmanly or something.
The whole Suzanne Farr wrote the seminal book about sexism and homophobia. That it's really about for men this fear of being seen as a woman, and it's all tangled up and involved.
Anyway, George was a giant, and he was also a Shakespeare scholar. You can read about him at georgeweinberg.com if you want, and I'll be writing about him for the Gay City News. But at the end of this interview, which again we'll post online, he encouraged people to be involved in their own liberation, and he said, I encourage everybody, if you love somebody, to do, I'm screwing up the quote, forget it. What he was basically saying is, if you do for others, you won't be lonely in life.
And you'll have a purpose.
Yes, that's the point.
All right. Well, Jimmy Breslin certainly had a purpose, which was to puncture the powerful and to cast doubt on everybody's pretensions.
Yes.
And for all his gruffness, he was a terrific friend and human being, and we both knew him well and loved him in all his gruffness. And he was certainly a friend to us and to the community. And he wrote very compassionately about AIDS in the early days of the discovery of the epidemic and won a Pulitzer Prize doing it.
1985 was when he wrote his AIDS column.
Yeah.
A number of them were about David Camacho, who was a young gay and political activist in the village. And he wrote about a Southern boy who was disowned by his parents when they came to the hospital room and found that he was gay and had AIDS at the same time. And he really had contempt for people who could not show compassion.
Yeah.
That was the way Jimmy was. He also wrote, said something. He said, what's wrong with journalists today? He said, they don't go out. Television would be your answer. They're all on television giving the news. As you listen to them talk, they haven't left the office.
Oops.
Well, we do sit here, but we get out.
Yes, we do. And he had the vision to marry, after he lost his first wife, who died of cancer, to marry the great and wonderful Ronnie Eldridge, who is a very longtime friend of ours and a fabulous human being. And so we send our condolences to Ronnie and the whole family. And
well, we were just at the funeral in the Catholic
were.
Church, but Jimmy wrote a column called The Church That Forgot Christ.
meaning his own church in 2004.
Well, Ronnie said at the service that she wasn't sure he would have approved of this, but she was in charge, so she was going to do it, and that was the church they were married in, so there they were.
He also said rage is the only quality which has kept me or anybody I've ever studied writing columns for newspapers.
Yeah, and we certainly bring that rage to this show, so Jimmy is definitely a hero of ours.
Yes.
And we'll miss him. All right, so on to the rage-inducing news this week.
Oh, my God. Well, yeah. Look, I watched as much as I could, a stomach of the Neil Gorsuch hearings. He's not saying anything.
Yeah.
But he is saying some things about who has influenced him in mm-hmm. life. And gosh, golly, he says all the time. of course, we all knew his role model was Scalia, who was the biggest anti-gay bigot on the court in the last 50 years.
I don't think he had any real role models.
He said his mentor was Justice Byron White, who also was from Colorado, as he was.
Nonsense.
Well, Byron White, and he clerked for White.
Yeah.
Byron White wrote the Hardwick decision saying it was okay to ban sodomy in the United States.
I think Neil Gorsuch has much too big an ego to really have mentors or heroes.
Well, he hung out with Scalia. We saw them hunting together.
Friends, certainly.
He called Paul Clement, who argued against same-sex marriage in the courts over the last couple of years in the federal courts, a dear friend. And he was a protege of this guy named John Finnis, who was a renowned Catholic scholar, who compared same-sex relations to bestiality and described abortion as the approved killing of vulnerable, innocent human beings. So this is who he is.
Well, Gorsuch at Oxford in 2004 wrote a dissertation. I don't know what he was doing at Oxford in 2004, but he was there and he wrote a dissertation saying there was no right to same-sex marriage.
Right.
And this, by the way, is after it had been legalized in Massachusetts.
And he also wrote, a former student reported that, who took his class, said that he said that many women manipulate their employers for maternity benefits and that law firms should ask female interviewees about their pregnancy plans in order to protect their companies. This is a really bad guy. Who says golly and gosh a lot.
Don't just believe us. Lambda Legal Defense calls him the more recklessly conservative than Scalia. The National Center for Lesbian Rights refers to his dangerously radical view of religious liberty. And he, of course, is the one who said that activists like those pushing for gay marriage rely too much on the courts and should be taking their case to the legislature or the people.
41 Democrats could filibuster him, but the Republicans have said that they will end the filibuster rule on Supreme Court nominations, as they were ended by the Democrats on federal judgeships and cabinet appointments.
So I found it very hard to watch him because I found him so smarmy, so oily, so condescending, pretentious. I thought he was completely untrustworthy in everything he said and was clearly there. But he wasn't like someone who just sits there and says, I'm sorry, I can't talk about that. You know, I'm going to be a judge. I just can't talk about it. He's like a guy who's still trying to prove he's the smartest guy in the room and like he can manipulate the process. And it wasn't an honest exchange. No. It was very untrustworthy. And he was asked about a couple of LGBT issues and will you treat LGBT people equally? Oh, yes. Everybody the
That's
same.
That's all he would say. He couldn't really talk about gay people.
No, but he said, I treat everybody the same.
Every person who comes to the court. And you're not going to have your marriage rights anymore. They alluded to the fact that the courts are considering ways of not recognizing marital benefits for gay couples. And I can't comment on that because I'm going to end those.
Well, he's also the person who wrote on his court level the Hobby Lobby decision.
Yes.
And that's all about extending these religious freedoms to allow people to discriminate. And that is the core of what we should be looking at. And Trump is peppering his cabinet, his Supreme Court appointments, whatever, with people like Gorsuch and Jeff Sessions and Ben Carson and all these people who want to assert that there is a religious law that supersedes civil law, and that is where he is trying to take this whole government, is to that kind, and that's a Bannon thing too, is that religious law should supersede civil law, and that is, to me, the
real
threat.
That's the end of America.
That is.
That is the end of America.
Now, I will say one thing to update something we talked a minute about last week, this whole thing about Trump's company protecting trademarks in China, including Trump escorts. Well, it turns out that another company had tried to trademark the name Trump Escort, so it's not like they're necessarily going to start an escort service in China, but they grabbed that name to protect it.
Well, let's talk about some of the things happening in the administration. The Department of Housing and Urban Development has withdrawn notices impacting our lives. They withdrew a requirement for emergency shelters receiving HUD funding to post information about LGBTQ people's rights to access to shelter safety. I mean, the UN even does this in Iraq, you know? But we're not going to do it in the United States anymore.
No. Forget non-discrimination rules. And they're chopping them away little by little.
And they don't want to collect any data on homeless LGBT people. And P.S., a highly disproportionate number of homeless people, not just teens, but adults, are LGBTQ.
And they are getting rid of collecting data on LGBT older Americans. There is a national survey of older Americans that for the last few years has included questions about sexual orientation and gender identity in an attempt to identify the needs of those populations, as we have asked for many years. The Obama administration put that in. The Trump administration has now cut that out.
Yeah, we only got it in.
We must be invisible.
We only got it in 2014.
Yeah, but it...
But it's gone
now. It's gone.
And we told you about how this international conference on the status of women is, the United States has invited the hate group Center for Family and Human Rights, CFAM, which is identified as a hate group by the Southern Poverty Law Center, to it. So Outright International is really on this. And saying, you know, trying to appeal to the Trump administration, trying to shame them, but they're beyond shame. I can't believe that they'll back down.
They're not backing down. They're defending the diversity of voices that they are bringing to an event like this.
Let's get the Nazi view of Passover, as my friend David Rothenberg used to say.
And CFAM is defending itself by saying that Outright is a bunch of radical homosexuals and modern-day fascists. Now, that's the kind of talk you want to hear from a group going to represent us at the UN.
This is too depressing to listen to. All my friends dying and all this terrible thing from the Trump. Let's give them some good news. The Osage Nation has enacted same-sex marriage. Not a lot of people showed up to vote, but enough people did that it passed.
Yes, and I want to just, before we entirely leave the Trump administration, note that former Wyoming Senator Alan Simpson, who's a quirky guy but always supported a Republican, supported Clarence Thomas, but he was always pro-LGBT, and he had an op-ed in the New York Times today, "Don't let the anti-LGBT bigots win."
Well, that's his appeal to the Trump administration, not to do this, but that's one of their raison d'etres.
Well, he's saying if you go along with the far-right wing on this, you're only going to energize the Democrats and help them raise money and get active and beat you.
And Trump, who won the electoral vote, did so by securing the votes of evangelicals. They knew that he was going to deliver for them, and he has delivered for them with Neil Gorsuch for the next 35 years.
And I believe they understood that all his protestations of support for us were nonsense, as we are trying to document as we go along. Right. So, and I want to bring in one other left field item. Obama came under a lot of criticism for not being active enough in Syria, and I sort of heard that and understood what was going on over there. But boy, was it brought home to me by watching the HBO documentary Cries from Syria. And I like to recommend to you things that I think will have an impact on your thinking and lives. And Cries from Syria on HBO, which is available on demand, there is horrifying, but well worth your time to watch it. It is an eye-opener. It is unbelievably, it's all shot by people on their iPhones close up in Syria. So it's not documentary cameras. It's real people taking real footage of what's happening in real time. And it just is, well, it will blow your mind.
As I've mentioned, my roommate works in Erbil in Kurdistan in Iraq. And Syrian refugees and Mosul refugees are flooding in at the rate of thousands a day.
Well, now,
to be put into camps. And it's, you know,
if you watch Cries from Syria, you will understand why. And you will understand why it is so atrocious that the Trump administration is cutting off refugees from coming here and from giving them any help.
Created all this dislocation, a lot of it, in the Middle East. I mean, I'm not saying it was a pleasant place in many ways under some of these regimes, but we created a lot of the chaos that created all this. So we have responsibility and should be taking more people in, as the Canadians have.
Yes.
Some other better news. The New Mexico legislature has a sentence bill banning so-called conversion therapy for young people to the governor's desk.
Okay. But in Arkansas, the state representative who had introduced the bill to stop recognizing marriages has withdrawn that. Nonetheless, there is the 15 bad bills remain in the legislature proposed in Arkansas.
Yeah.
And an anti-transgender representative is now making this argument against people, redefining their gender identity. What if a 24-year-old man says, I'm 14, so I can have sex with a 14-year-old girl?
My God. Well, we're going to get to that with other. But this one of these Arkansas bills would impose.
I laugh.
One of these Arkansas bills would impose a criminal record on a transgender person who uses a locker room or a similar facility that is consistent with their gender identity, even if they haven't done anything wrong.
In Pennsylvania, in Phoenixville, they have adopted a non-discrimination law for sexual orientation and gender identity and expression.
On the other hand, in Pennsylvania, there's this high school boy who says he was humiliated and emotionally harmed by being forced to share a locker room and bathrooms with a transgender boy. So this is all being run by Alliance Defending Freedom, the right-wing legal group. And they're trying to use our arguments about the discomfort, you know, we feel in certain situations to not help this boy, but use this boy to try to undo what we're doing.
In Georgia, a right-wing legislator has tried to slip into a bill at the last minute and, a religious freedom expansion for state-funded adoption agencies and foster care agencies. At the last minute, he put this in. And the guy who's turning out to be a good friend of ours, the Republican governor of Georgia, Nathan Deal, is outraged by this.
I don't want this to happen, he said.
Yep. So the thinking, he's vetoed stuff before, and I would expect he would not allow this to be made law.
And he says the other problem is you're jeopardizing the adoption bill by sticking this in.
On the other hand, not such a good friend of ours is the governor of Kentucky, Matt Bevin, who signed the legislation expanding religious freedom for government-financed student clubs at high schools and colleges so that they can reject people on the basis of sexual orientation or anything else.
It passed the House 81-8 in Kentucky.
I'd call that fear.
I'd say we have a lot of work to do
and
out
hatred
there, everywhere. By the way, we're talking about all these states. We do have a website that you can go to that will tell you where to find. We have the. Can we put that up there? EqualityFederation.org/LAC. You can find out what's going on in your state with not just anti-LGBT legislation, but pro-LGBT legislation.
Did we mention Alabama?
No.
The House there has okayed a religious freedom expansion for state-licensed and funded adoption and foster care agencies. And in Tennessee, the House there approved no rights for same-sex couples, married couples, or parents. This is one of the new maneuvers they're trying, we've talked about this before, states around the country, Texas is trying this, where they somehow decide that they have the right to take away all rights from same-sex married couples,
yes.
That they can treat us unequally. And they're not going to get away with it. This is going to be challenged, but it's going to be a lot of work and a lot of court time to beat it back.
I don't believe we're going to get Gorsuch's vote on that, but he is replacing Scalia, and we still have a 5-4 pro-marriage equality majority on the court for now.
I will go out on a limb to say that I think not even Justice Roberts would sit still for that kind of violation of equal protection.
We'll see.
On the other hand, where is this? Justice Alito gave a horrendous speech. Let me see if I can find this. Go ahead. Here it is. He was speaking to a group of Catholic lawyers and judges. This is Justice Samuel Alito.
Is this the
Alito.
Thomas More Society?
Maybe. He says that there is a growing hostility to traditional moral beliefs, and we must evangelize for religious freedom. This is a justice of the Supreme Court of the United
States.
Where
is the value, accepting strangers, embracing
yes.
the other,
yes.
Those kinds of things?
Well, that's not their God.
You know, we're not trying to make you engage in homosexual activity if you don't want to, but we're saying leave us alone.
Well, they think we are.
Well. All right. Now
you used to have a slogan when we were teaching in schools. Yes, we do promote homosexuality for homosexuals.
Yeah, right. And we've talked about how bad things are in some of these states, but people are fighting back. There was a rally in Arkansas. In Kansas, LGBT advocates marched on the state house, mm-hmm. dozens of them, to protest this proposed bathroom law there. Here's some good news from Texas. Bobby Brooks is the first openly gay president of the Texas A&M student body. How about that?
Very, very good.
Yes.
NOM, the National Organization for Marriage, it turns out, is not dead, and they're fighting back. We showed you a week ago, the bus they were running around Spain with,
yes.
Orange wrapped with an anti-trans slogan. Well, now it's going to be running around the United States of America.
Right.
Actually, they've also turned it into a billboard in Guatemala City. But here's the giveaway on this. Here's where they're going to be running it. In New York City at the UN and Trump Tower.
That's like wearing a Make America Great hat again.
At Yale University in New Haven, in Boston, Philly, and D.C. So to me, this says, we want you to attack us,
yes.
so that we can look like victims and we can make the case that you are nasty,
ignore
homo fascists.
Ignore them.
Please.
Ignore
please
them.
Please ignore them.
Ignore them. All right.
And I guess we should ignore the wife of the governor of Idaho, Mrs. Otter, who tweeted a little anti-Caitlyn Jenner joke about Wheaties boxes, and it was just nasty. And now she's apologized, but really, we think she meant it.
In Oklahoma, a family values senator, that's who usually does these kinds of things, was charged with hiring a teenage boy as a prostitute and is resigning as a lawmaker. Ralph Shorty, 35. He was charged with 3 felony counts, including engaging in child prostitution. This is one of our enemies.
Not good.
An enemy of himself, homophobia.
Exactly. Probably hates himself.
Well, how about that decision in South Carolina?
Yeah, that's a good one.
All right.
So a lesbian couple who had been together for 30 years separated, and one of them was suing for, division of property and spousal support, and her ex said, well, we were never married,
yeah.
you have no rights. I hate it when people do that. 30 years together. And so they were in court, and the judge said, you know what? You are a common law couple. You are going to be recognized as married. You're even going to be recognized retroactively as married for the last 30 years.
Let's repeat that again.
So there.
Retroactive common law marriage because you were together all that time.
Yep. And Ms. X, you cannot get away with now like the federal government, making your spouse invisible.
Okay. Some violence to report. Another LGBT center has been vandalized. The Hudson Pride Connections Center in Jersey City. It happened before the staff arrived on Monday. It's being investigated as a bias crime over there in Jersey City.
Outside Madison Square Garden in New York, a gay man was verbally and physically assaulted, had his life threatened. They did arrest the attacker.
In Jackson Heights, Queens, the most diverse neighborhood in the world, where they speak 161 languages, a Long Island man from, I guess, further out on Long Island, attacked two transgender women on Friday afternoon, shouting anti-gay slurs as he beat them outside a fast food restaurant. This guy, Patrick O'Meara, has been charged with a hate crime. You know, he left the scene, he came back, one of the victims had a fractured ankle from the assault.
In other not quite so violent forms of violence, in D.C., in a House of Representatives office, some not altogether together guy went and ripped a rainbow flag off the outside of the office of California Representative Alan Lowenthal, who I believe is not gay, but just supportive, and then went into the office and yelled gay slurs at the staff. The representative's response was, let's pass the Equality Act.
Things are getting out of hand out there. On the other hand, in Indianapolis, a man there was sentenced to more than 30 years for his involvement in the attempted murder of his former partner. They had a order of protection for a while, then they saw each other again, and he tried to kill him. But he has gotten 30 years for that.
Now, I'm curious about this, what the Pentagon is doing about this Marine scandal. They, you know, there's this whole thing about male Marines posting these nude pictures of female Marines online. Kirsten Gillibrand is out of her mind with anger about this. But now they say they're going to focus on gay male porn being posted or nude pictures of men.
There are some sites called like Active Duty, I think is the name of one of them, where the guys at least dressed in military garb.
But aren't they consensual?
Yes, they're consensual, but
I think they're kind of trying to deflect attention from what's been done to these women by focusing on these gay male sites as if they were the same kind of exploitation.
Yes. I don't know what the rules are in terms of somebody active in the military appearing in a porn film.
I think it may be illegal, but it's not the same kind of exploitation. And this is a diversion from what has happened to these women and their inability to control the men who have posted those pictures.
Indeed.
And also, YouTube has apologized. Turns out that they have been censoring some LGBT content. Not us, I'm happy to say. But 'cause we are nowhere near pornographic. But they've been censoring non-pornographic LGBT content, and now they say they're going to fix that. If you have any experience of them not fixing it,
well, some of the founders of YouTube are gay, aren't they? I think I read that.
Probably.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
In Glastonbury, Connecticut, a tragic story of a young trans girl, Alexis, in the process of discovering her true identity, bullied at school and online and took her life. Very sad.
All right.
And in
In better trans news, the openly trans chief executive Michaela Mendelson is starting the a group to help trans people find work. She's chief executive of Polo West Corporation. She came out as transgender.
Well,
they
were featured in the Katie Couric National Geographic special. Their story was told, and it's a very heartwarming story. I want to run a tape from the Human Rights Campaign. They produced this little video of a mother of a trans child talking about how she is scared for her daughter, and it's quite eloquent and moving, and I thought you might like to see it.
This is hard for our family. When my daughter was about to start kindergarten, they would not accept her. So my husband and I then made a sacrifice where I stopped working for the sake of her safety, and we dropped below the poverty level just so that we could keep her safe and homeschool her. Being hungry, finding housing, it was hard. And you know, you kind of hope that at some point things change. We have our daughter, and we have three wonderful black boys, and statistics show that there's a good chance she will not make it to age 35. It is hard enough that I have to have a discussion about where she needs to use a bathroom when it's there, but it is the least of my worries. My worries is that someone will murder her and that I will have to bury her. My worries are that her wonderful, loyal brothers will be so upset that they lost their amazing big sister that then I will have to either bury them or I have to see them in prison. My mother cried on the phone and said, "I marched in Washington to see Martin Luther King Jr. speak, and I had hoped by the time you were here, I wouldn't have to march. And now I have to march again for my granddaughter. She is my Trinity. She is my everything." And to hear people say the things they say in regards to her and to all the trans youth, you did not give birth to that child. And I brought this beautiful life into this world in hopes that she would be treated like any other American. And she is an American. She is a beautiful black American.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. The great thing about our time is parents standing up for their kids.
It's so heartwarming. What a great family.
Yes.
You might also want to take a look at the current issue, I think it's the current issue, of Time Magazine cover story, Beyond He or She, which examines gender identity in all its complexity. GLAAD, formerly the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, says that 20% of millennials, those I guess under 25, identify other than straight or cisgender. That's quite a number.
Well, why would you want to identify as heterosexuality? There's a new book by Han, H-A-N-N-E blank, Straight, The Surprisingly Short History of Heterosexuality. Did you read about this?
Yes, I did.
In 1901, the medical dictionary defined heterosexuality as an abnormal or perverted appetite towards the opposite sex. And then in 23, they called it a morbid sexual passion for the opposite sex. It wasn't until 1934 that heterosexuality was what we say today, which is just an attraction to people of the other sex.
In Chicago, I'm just moving on, a class action lawsuit was settled for $3.75 million against Standard Innovation of Canada. Turns out they were selling a smart vibrator that collected data and could be turned on remotely.
Don't tell Donald Trump.
Well, now they are destroying all the data and paying $3.75 million.
Good Lord.
There are problems with the new age.
I don't know how to segue from that, but I do want to tell you what happened on St. Patrick's Day.
It
went off fine in Boston without vets. And in New York, I felt we should, there's the New York delegation, there's Danny Drum. And the second from the
left. Tom Duane on the left.
Yes, and the second from the left is Senator.
From
the left is Senator O'Riordan, the tall guy. He is the guy, we ran his whole clip. He's the Irish senator who stood up on the floor and called Trump a fascist. That clip has been seen 45 million times, literally 45 million times. times. And so it made him kind of a celebrity.
It was excellent. Kind of.
He objects to his own government playing footsie with Trump, even though the prime minister, the Taoiseach, Kenny, did stand up to Trump a little bit on immigration when they gave speeches together.
Yes.
And that has already gotten 40 million hits. Seriously, these Irish, I mean, it's a small country.
I think it's one overweight guy in his bedroom hitting 40 million times.
But the point about O'Riordan is, you know, he marched with the gay group in the New York St. Patrick's Day parade. Our delegation was a little smaller this year than it was last year. We got to build it up for next year. It's good to be able to be out there in March. But then he held a big thing at Riverside Church that evening called Irish Stand. 3 hours of lefties, basically, you know, condemning the Trump administration and offering hope to each other.
Nice.
Yeah.
Trans man Mel Wymore, who ran for the city council in New York, is running again. He came very close last time, and he is going to try again on the Upper West Side of Manhattan.
Okay.
Look for that. And congratulations to Rafael Bostic, the first out gay black president and CEO of a Federal Reserve Bank in Atlanta. He is taking over the Federal Reserve Bank and, you know, comes with very high praise. So congratulations to him.
And the out lesbian assembly member from Greenwich Village, she's been there forever, Deborah Glick, has proposed a $10 fine if you don't vote. I think it's interesting. Australia and 24 other countries do this. Doesn't mean you have to fill out the ballot. You have to get the ballot. You have to. You can spoil it if you want. I'm not against it.
I am. I don't believe in coercion. I believe in persuasion. Well,
it at least
$10 fine
if you don't deal with it.
Okay. I want to thank Katy Perry, pop singer, who appeared at the HRC LA dinner and talked about how she had always been sort of bi-curious, but she was raised in a fundamentalist household, and so she was brainwashed into, you know, supporting conversion therapy. That's what they were doing at that time. But she believes that sexuality is not so black and white, and it turns out that her big song, I Kissed a Girl, she said, actually, I did more than that. Katy Perry, thank you.
Right.
So she has come out as really seriously bi when everybody thought she was just playing with it. In fact, a lot of people thought she was exploiting us with that song.
No.
But it turns out that there was a really serious underpinning for that.
In AIDS news,
we're not going to do international news?
Oh, we got international news first, yes.
I mean, that's just our normal
routine.
Put it
in the wrong place. Let's do international news.
All right. Well, in Taiwan, a lesbian who was forced to marry a man by family pressure left him after a few days. Now the court has ordered her to pay him $16,000 to reimburse wedding fees, his betrothal money, and for emotional pain.
Okay.
I don't think she should be held responsible.
In Japan,
her family maybe should be held responsible because they are the ones who forced her into the marriage.
In Japan, the first openly trans man has been elected to public office. They elected a trans woman many, many years ago, 2003. But Tomoya Hosoda is 25 and was elected a councilor in the city of Iruma.
Also in Japan, Sapporo is going to be the first major city to recognize same-sex couples. Districts of Tokyo, I think, and other places are doing that, but this is the whole city is going to recognize them.
Now, I had not remembered that Rodrigo Duterte, the head of the Philippines, had said something about legalizing same-sex marriage during the campaign or something. Well, it's not going to happen.
We're a Catholic country. I'm kind of grateful for that. I don't want to be associated with him. He just goes around and shoots people.
Killer Duterte.
Yeah. So
Trump likes him.
I'm happy for that consistency. In Germany, they are going to void the prosecution of tens of thousands of gay men under paragraph 175, the Nazi-era anti-gay law, and they're going to pay some reparations. And that's nice.
In Australia, in Queensland, the state there has abolished the gay panic criminal defense for murder.
In Buenos Aires, Argentina, you may remember we told you about how the Second Avenue subway here opened recently and they had some Chuck Close portraits on the walls.
Yes.
And one was a gay male couple. Well, this is a gay activist. I'm going to murder this name, so forgive me. Carlos Juaregui?
J-A-U-R-E-G-U-I.
He was a famous gay activist who died at the age of 38 or 9, and they have now named the entire subway station after him and made these lovely rainbow-colored stairs in the subway station. And this is a big deal to dedicate this whole station to a gay activist in Buenos Aires.
There's a very brave activist in Trinidad and Tobago, Jason Jones, in the Caribbean there, who has received more than 50 death threats just for challenging the anti-sodomy laws down there.
India has denied a visa to an American trans woman judge, Victoria Kulikowski. She is the first elected transgender trial court judge in the U.S. She was going to India to speak on LGBT issues, and that is exactly why they have barred her entry and refused her a visa.
Mm-hmm.
Not good news from India. In Mexico City, not all of Mexico, but just Mexico City, they are reporting 8,000 same-sex marriages since 2010. Mm. Interesting. And we mentioned Guatemala City is going to have those anti-trans billboards, the ones that, you know, that bus in Spain was rejected by the government and outlawed, but coming to a city near you here.
We have a First Amendment.
Yes, we do, but we need a little restraint not to
that would be nice.
Wreck violence on the bus. Now, all right, now AIDS news.
Well, we sit here in New York City. We are AIDS educators, I guess, still. But we did a lot of it in the schools, and we got it institutionalized in the schools. Everybody's supposed to do 6 lessons every year at every grade level. Well, the NYCLU did a survey on it, and the kids are saying, we're not getting any AIDS lessons, and there is no integration. There's hardly any integration of LGBT issues in the schools. Now, folks,
they don't have much sex education at all.
Oh, actually, under Bloomberg, they mandated sex education. I'm just saying these things are mandated, and they are not done.
I would agree with that. They are not done,
yeah.
No matter how much they're mandated. And even the mandate is so minor that even if they were fulfilling that, it would be far from enough.
6 lessons on AIDS is an opportunity to talk about a lot of issues.
Absolutely.
And, to talk about LGBT issues. But people are uncomfortable with it still in New York, and this is an outrage.
You know, if you survey parents, you find a vast majority do want the schools to do sex education and this kind of education, but the schools themselves are nervous about it, and the politicians are nervous
about
it.
Well, that's why we used to get asked in as outside speakers, because the teachers themselves were nervous about talking about this in front of the kids, so they'd have an outsider do it.
And
still do.
We'd be happy to go back, but presumably there are younger people who could do it.
Yes.
I do remember going to a suburban high school once to talk to a parents' meeting, PTA meeting, about doing sex and AIDS education in that high school. And there was a parent there, a woman, who got up and was very adamant about how, I'm going to teach my kid at home, you're not going to do this, I want to control it. And I said, look, I totally support you doing that. I hope you do it. But most parents don't.
Right.
And don't these other kids deserve an education? And it totally took the wind out of her sails, and she ended up agreeing.
There are some liberal parents who think that the programs in the schools are going to be too conservative, and so they don't want, they opt their kids out.
Abstinence, abstinence, abstinence.
Right. Well,
there are kids who, we've heard some recent reports about how that has messed with people's minds.
It's not
minds.
A good idea.
Yeah.
All right.
So, yeah, ever vigilant. Well, in Florida, the Supreme Court ruled in the case of a HIV-positive gay man who lied to his sex partner, produced a phony report that he was HIV negative with a doctor's signature on it somehow.
That's not very nice.
He tried to escape prosecution by saying the law requiring disclosure before sexual intercourse only applied to straight sex. This guy's a charmer. And the court said no, gay sex is sex, especially because of the higher rate of infection among gay men. Now, I was on a panel last week about HIV criminalization, which I've decided should instead be called HIV decriminalization. And these are tricky issues, and people get, you know, you think sex education is makes people nervous. People being prosecuted for HIV, really, you know, people get up in arms about
thus
the need to do that.
All the crazy laws against it.
But as we talked about on that panel, people have to protect themselves. They have a duty to do that, and that's how you can be sure that you're not going to be put at risk by someone who is lying. And clearly, if someone is lying and is deliberately trying to work like that, then they should be subject to prosecution, perhaps, but for assault or whatever. But to write laws that are specifically about HIV, I got a big hand when I said, why aren't we prosecuting men who are giving women HPV and causing cervical cancer right. and causing deaths from that? Why is that not seen right. as something prosecutable? And the reason
don't give them any ideas.
Well, you're not doing that. But there is still such stigma around yes. HIV that we don't want to teach it in the schools. We want to prosecute people for having sex, and we don't want to understand the nuances of this, and we right. want to single it out, and right. that's no good.
Right. I mean, and the main reason that infections are going down is because more and more people are getting on the drugs, and they're not
yes.
infecting each other.
Yes, they're not
people,
infectious.
And people are on PrEP, to you know, which is preventing them from getting infected.
Right.
All right.
All right, entertainment news. All right,
well, how about that RuPaul?
Well, he came out about being married.
We have a picture there of Georges Labarre, his spouse, at Georges' Wyoming ranch.
There's George on the left and RuPaul in a cowboy hat on the right. I don't know who the woman in the middle is.
Maybe she did the service.
Maybe. That's possible. But George and RuPaul have been together for 23 years, and they got married a couple of months ago in Wyoming.
Now, can it be that Becky G...
Actually, I'm not sure that's where they were married, but George does have
can
a ranch.
I don't watch Becky G as Yellow Power Ranger, but this apparently is the first character ever, a superhero movie, to feature a gay protagonist as a character. It's almost hard to believe.
It is, but this is Becky G, who's a pop star, as Trini, the Yellow Power Ranger, who in the new Power Ranger movie will be coming to terms with her sexuality. First big budget superhero movie with an LGBT protagonist.
Right.
I think that's possible.
Well, you'll tell us if it's out there, if it's not. The original Blue Ranger actor, David Yost, was openly gay when he took on that role, but he ended up leaving the series in the late 90s because he said he was being harassed so much over his sexual orientation, but he's thrilled about this.
By the way, I should have done this first. RuPaul is talking to producers about a half-hour sitcom about his life to be produced by J.J. Abrams, among others. They don't have a title for it yet. How could it not be Superstar?
Who will play Ru?
Or Work.
Who will play Ru? It'd have to be Ru.
I would
Jackie
certainly
Robinson
think he'd
played
be
himself
trying.
In his bio movie.
Ru would be certainly interested in playing Ru, and who could play Ru?
Well, the character of Jesus on Walking Dead has come out as gay. Look, I have a friend named Jesus who's gay, too. And Jesus Christ himself had a beloved disciple, lest we forget. That's no joke.
I think we're burying the lead, though, which is that Beauty and the Beast has come out of the gate as a huge hit. I think the maybe the quickest, biggest grossing family movie, certainly Disney movie of all time, 100 and $70 million in its first weekend, domestically and internationally. It's a huge, huge hit. Biggest family movie ever. Bill Condon, the director.
Openly gay.
Yep.
He directed Kinsey.
Yes.
He directed Chicago, I think.
Yes. And the music by Menken and Ashman, also at least one of them gay. And so a gay-made movie, and it has this little moment only of a gay character, and that was enough to set off homophobes around the world. But it certainly has not fazed audiences, which are taking this in stride and couldn't care less.
Even Malaysia is going to show the uncut version.
So to speak. The movie censorship board in Malaysia rejected Beauty and the Beast without getting rid of the gay scene. If you don't get rid of the gay scene, we're not allowing it to be shown. So it went to the appeals board, and they said, absolutely not. It's a big hit, and we want other U.S. companies to do business here. We want all the other U.S. films. We are not going to get the reputation for censoring stuff like this. Bring it on.
I want to recommend two plays on Broadway, especially Arthur Miller's The Price, the revival, with Mark Ruffalo, Tony Shalhoub, Danny DeVito, and Jessica Hecht. Danny DeVito is unbelievably hilarious and good and touching, and I think this is really a play for our times in many, many ways, and tremendously moving, so I recommend that. And Come From Away. This is the sweet musical made by the Canadian pair about all these people who had to land in Gander, Canada, on planes on 9/11 because they were all being grounded. 28 jumbo, jets have to land there, and they're stuck there for days. It is one of the most energetic shows I've ever seen in my life. It was almost goes on for 100 minutes, and they never stop moving.
Dancing on the runway?
Well, they have to play the Ganderites, and they have to play the passengers. Justin Trudeau tried to take Donald Trump and took Ivanka to it. I hope it moves them. It's not the most groundbreaking show, but it certainly is sweet.
And I want to recommend the best movie I saw at the New Fest LGBT Film Festival last fall, now available on video on demand on Vimeo and Amazon and shortly on iTunes and Amazon Prime, Suicide Kale. Sounds terrible, doesn't it?
Oh, I heard about this.
I talked about it at the time.
Right.
It's it's a little lesbian sitcom, and it is hilarious and so well done, so well acted, so well written. Suicide Kale is well worth your time. And
where can we see it now again?
Video on demand.
All right.
On Vimeo and Amazon first, and then iTunes and Amazon Prime.
Okay.
And free speech is still in pledge mode for another week or so.
Until April 5th.
Yeah, but you can catch us always online at gayusatv.org.
And you can get on our email list if you go to our website. You can get on our email list and get a preview of the program every week.
And Chris Cooper will be here for me next week, but I'll be back the following week.
And what George Weinberg said was, if you have somebody to do something for on this earth, you're not lonely.
Bye.